To set up and install the AftrBurner engine, the first step that we need to begin doing is downloading the archive file itself. So I'm just going to begin downloading from the website. I'm going to save the link and I'm going to place it in C:\repo. So I'm making a new folder called repos. This is where we want to put this 7-zip file. I have also already downloaded and installed 7-zip. So now that we are downloading the repo, we have to go and download our compiler. The compiler that we will be using is Microsoft Visual Studio 2022 Community Edition. That is a free download. Currently, it is in the preview stage, so we're just going to download the preview. Then we can launch the installer. When we install, there are several options we must choose in order to get the C++ compiler set up. Within Visual Studio, we are going to check the checkbox. Let me make this a little bigger here. We're going to check the checkbox for desktop development with C++. And underneath our setup here, choose the options selected in red on the screen. I'm going to click install. That'll take a little bit of time to install. And in the meantime, we have our Git repo downloading right here. We are at 10 gigs of 23 gigs. All right. Additionally, we also need Git for Windows as well as CMake. So while those are installing in the background, let's search for Git for Windows. This gitforwindows.org will take us straight to our download link. We can click download. Git has now downloaded to our machine. We can choose to install it. When we install Git, there are several options we must choose in the installer. All right, so we can come through, we can leave all of these as the defaults. If you want, you can add a Git bash profile to the Windows terminal if you like that new Windows terminal. That's a fine option. I like doing that. Then I will use Vim for my default editor when there's a merge conflict or something like that. I will let Git decide for this option. I choose the checkbox to use Git and optional Unix tools from the command prompt. You must check this checkbox because some of my scripts require the ability to execute a shell script. Okay? So within a Git bash, you will be able to use Unix command tools, and my scripts rely on those. I will use the bundled OpenSSH. I'll use the standard SSL library. And I will choose checkout as is and commit as is. Here I will use the default Windows console. And then I will also choose the default for fast forward or merge. You do not want to rebase. The Credential Manager, this is a nice feature to remember your username and password, so you only need to type it once. Now, right here, we can enable file system caching, which makes Git work quite a bit faster. However, on this checkbox, it's important that we do not enable any of these new experimental features. If we enable sudo consoles, we almost get non-deterministic launching of shell scripts with that feature enabled. And if you check this box, every folder that you have a Git repo in, it will launch another sub-process. That sub-process will lock the folder when our scripts try to rename the files and folders. So we don't want either of these boxes checked. All right, this will install Git, and we'll be able to open up a terminal as soon as the installation here is done. We can launch a git bash. We don't need the release notes. Okay, so now it looks like we have our git bash installed. The other thing that we need is we need the latest version of CMake. All right, CMake is our cross-platform build tool. So if we search for CMake right here, we can go straight to the downloads section of it, and we can get the Win64 installer right here. So I will choose to download this. The download has now finished. We can install CMake. All right, we'll run CMake. When we run CMake, we want to make sure that we add CMake to the path for all users. So I'm going to do add CMake to path for all users. That will be necessary for the scripts to work right. Then we can do the default install. Visual Studio has now finished installing, so we can complete our CMake installation. All right, we have CMake installed. Visual Studio appears to be successfully installed. We can choose to launch Visual Studio for the first time.
You can sign in with a Microsoft account. I will choose that our development settings will be C++, and I will choose the dark mode. I can then start Visual Studio. And it's preparing for first use, whatever that means. All right, we can continue without code, and the application should successfully open. All right, this looks good. So now we have successfully completed, there we can exit that, our installation of, I already did 7-zip, we've installed CMake, we've installed Git, we've installed the compiler, and we've downloaded our 24-gigabyte repo, and that repo is located in C:/repos.
Now we want to extract the 7-zip archive into repos. To do that, we right-click, go to 7-zip, and say extract here. Once these directories are extracted, we'll notice that there aren't any files inside of them. Each directory only contains a .git folder. These .git folders contain the bare cloned repository that inside of that git pack the actual files are. So all we need to do here is extract those files. To do that, we simply run this shell script right here. Actually, all you need to do is run it, and it is extracting properly. So just if the shell script doesn't work or you get a weird error, just run the shell script again. And again, this is made worse if you enable those experimental options inside of Git for Windows.
We will observe that the extraction scripts for each folder complete when they say the word done afterwards. So I can sort of pan through and see, okay, the engine checkout is done, the libs checkout is done, user, modules is still going, shadows, and doc. So we're going to wait for modules to finish. Once the modules are done, we have now fully completed all of our checking out. So we can close these windows.
And now that all of the files are extracted, we can see that there are actually files inside of our repo. Okay, and these are the files that we'll be working with. The next thing we need to do is we have all the files on our hard drive, but we need to let our system environment be aware of some of the new DLLs we have. And we also need to create some environment variables that let CMake find where these libraries are installed on our computer. So for that, we go into the libs folder. We will run this extract third-party shell script. So when we run this shell script, it will launch several different extraction windows that will unzip all of these 7-zip archives in parallel. And again, the script terminates when we see the cursor again blinking at the bottom of the window. So we can sort of go through and see if all of them have completed. We've observed here boost is only 8% done, so that one usually takes the longest. Here we can also see that OpenCV is still extracting. So we'll wait for OpenCV.
We have now successfully completed extracting boost and OpenCV, and so all of our libraries are extracted now, so we can close these extraction windows.
The next thing we need to do is we need to run this bat file right here, which creates environmental variables. So I'm going to right click, but I need to run this as administrator in order to have access to modify my system path. So I will run this as administrator. This bat file might take up to 20 seconds to run. After this bat file can
completes, we can validate that our environment variables have been installed, because if we look at our environment, we now have this after third party bin folder right here. And inside of it, it shows, hey, here is where our SDL library is, OpenCV, PCL, GDL, as a free type, all of our other libraries. And so when we run CMake to try to build the engine or build a module, CMake will be able to look at our environment variables and say, oh, I'm looking for libfmt. Oh, okay, there's a thing called fmt_dir, and it takes me to the CMake file for that library. And this is how CMake sort of connects things together to find things for you. So you can see we have one for GLM, for Google Test, for Format, for our Open Dynamics Engine, OpenCV, our Point Cloud library, all kinds of other things in libraries. So this is all looking good.
And now we are completely ready to compile the engine. All right, so we're gonna build the engine from source. How do we do that? Well, we've already installed Visual Studio. And if we go into the engine folder, we will see that there is a bat file called build 64-bit MSVC 2022. What this script does is it launches CMake and says, hey CMake, I want you to configure a project to compile using the Windows compiler on Windows for a Windows executable. Okay, and here you can sort of see as it flashes through the screen all of the different libraries that we've installed.
So now that this GUI has come up, I can click configure and I can click generate. And notice how when we click configure, no red text came through our output. If anything red appeared, we might need to take a look at it and make sure that all of our files are in the correct place. But just glancing through, we can see that it found boost inside of repos libs boost. It found GDAL inside of repos GDAL. It found SDL, ASMP, lib format, all of those other things. Okay, what this bat file did was when we ran it, it created this folder called C164. This folder is a temporary folder that you can delete at any time you want. You never add anything inside of C164 into Git or under version control. These are temporary files that can be automatically generated by the machine.
If I go inside of the C164 folder, we can see that we have an Afterburner Engine solution file for Visual Studio. If I double click that, this is what we installed Visual Studio for. So I can just say, yeah, let's always open this up with Visual Studio.
And this will actually now have a solution that we can use to compile the engine.
So if we sort of look underneath these tabs right here, we can see that the engine has all of these source files and header files. Okay, this is what we need to compile. In order to compile, we can say, let's go to build, batch build. And when we compile the engine, we always check the checkbox for install debug and install min-size rel x64. So I'm gonna check these two checkboxes right here. And this will begin compiling the engine. Compiling the engine takes probably, depending on how fast your computer is, anywhere from 20 seconds to a couple minutes. I've given it about 30 seconds, and now we have finished compilation of the entire engine. The very last thing that happens is the engine will install into userland a whole bunch of header files as well as a library.
So after compilation is complete, we can verify that there is an AFTR folder inside of user include. Prior to the full compilation, this folder did not exist and there was nothing to see here. After the installation is complete, we have this AFTR folder. We also have several new CMake files in here that we don't really need to worry about. And then we also have this Afterburner engine.lib and the Afterburner engine debug. So this is the min-size rel and the debug library that our modules will link against. So now that we've compiled the engine is built, it's on our machine, everything is ready to go. What we need to do now is build a module.
To build a module, we will go to the user modules folder, and the default module that we want to build from, the default template, is inside of newmodule.zip. So we're going to right click, go to 7-zip, extract here. This will extract a new folder called new module, which went right here. If I open up new module, we'll notice this parallels the same setup as the engine folder. Again, now that the engine is built into a library and a set of headers, we want to use those to link against when we build our module. When we build our module, we will again run CMake. So we start by running this MSVC 2022 CMake bat. This begins running CMake and it sets up a whole nother solution for our new module. We can see it's now created the C164 folder And once CMake appears and we click configure and generate, a solution file will appear. So here, let's open up our new module. And if we go to CMake, now that CMake has popped up, we will click configure, generate. And now we can see that we have a new solution right here. So I can click either open project or I can double click on this. And now that our new module is open, the source code for our simple new module. So if we look at our main is a few lines of code. Our module is very simple load map where we just have a grass plane. And what we can do now is simply hit play. Now I'm running on a virtual machine. And because I'm running on a virtual machine, I do not have the OpenGL 3.2 or higher. So I expect this to crash. And if you try to run it and you're running on a computer that doesn't have a video card, you will probably observe a crash on a GL function call. That's okay, that's very easy to fix. All we have to do is go to our configuration file, and in our configuration file, change line 44 to say that our OpenGL context version should be 2.1. We'll save that file, and again, that file was located in the root of our new module. Now that that is done, let's hit rerun again. And now we can see that we have a sort of very dark world that we're moving around in. And the skybox, the clouds and everything, that texture is bigger than 1024 by 1024 pixels. And because this virtual machine has such an old version of OpenGL, it only supports a max texture size of 1024 by 1024. So that texture did not load right, which is why this is a white screen. But for all of you who have an actual video card, that will not be a problem. So at this point, you have the engine fully running. And in fact, we could pop in, hit the sphere, come back. And I believe within 5 seconds, it should come back. So we now have the engine running and everything is great. Congratulations.